From the Library of Congress and the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture.
Okay.
This is Emilye Crosby, and it's May 29th, 2017, 2013. And I'm here with John Bishop, and we're interviewing Mr. Lonnie King in one of the Southwest Library branch of the Fulton County Library here in Atlanta, as part of the Southern Oral History Project's Civil Rights History Project, sponsored by the Smithsonian Museum of African American History and Culture and the Library of Congress. Is it American Folklife Center?
The American Folklife Center, AFC.
And so, Mr. King, we're very pleased that you're with us here today.
Well, thank you very much for coming to record my comments about this great era in our history.
It is. It's obviously so important. Can you tell me about your family and your early background?
Yes, I was born in a little town called Arlington, Georgia, which is down 27 miles southwest of Albany. The county was Calhoun County. My mother's name was Bertha Lee Smith King, and she was one of 17 children. My father's name was L.C. King, Sr. He had about seven or eight brothers and sisters. They divorced when I was about two, I guess. And I stayed with my grandfather until I was eight. My grandfather kept me real until he died, and then they sent me to Atlanta to be with my mother. I guess, Dr. Crosby, if I had to pinpoint my beginnings, I have to say I believe that I was born looking up at the bottom. I was not on the bottom. I was looking up at the bottom. I was up there. So the likelihood that I might even go to college, much less finish college and do some other things, was probably a little remote, considering the environment that I grew up in. However, I have to attribute a great deal of my desire for freedom and my passion and my commitment, and I guess my long-distance running attitude, to my grandfather, who was my mentor. He's Reverend Joseph P. Smith. He was an evangelist who also was a note singer with perfect pitch in his voice. He was a tremendous person. And a lot of my feelings about matters and my attitudes about matters today flow from those years, those 6 years I was under his tutelage. And as I reflect in talking to you now, I guess it's akin to what John Locke once said, that what you teach a child in the first 6 years of their lives will influence how they're going to be for the rest of their lives, what you write on that blank slate. And I guess my granddad wrote a few things on my blank slate. One of the things that I know he wrote on my blank slate was the fact that one day we had to change the system. I remember in 1942, I was walking home from school. I was in the first grade, and I saw my first plane crop duster drop leaflets. That was the way they campaigned during those days in rural areas. And so I picked up one of the leaflets and took it home. And I could read every word, understood every word that I read, because they had taught me to read before I went to school. But that was one word that I didn't understand. Now the crop duster was hired by Eugene Talmadge, who was running for governor at that time. I said, "Granddaddy, what is a nigger?" He said, "Where'd you get that from?" I said, "The plane just dropped this, and I picked it up. And I understand everything, but I have never heard of a nigger. What is a nigger? what do you mean keep a nigger in his place? Keep the nigger in his place. He said, come on and sit on my knee, let me talk to you. And he proceeded to tell me about Talmadge and about racism. And a comment that he made to me sticks with me today. He said, you know, we're still in a form of slavery. The difference is that we can go home at night and we don't have anybody who's an assigned overseer. But for all practical purposes, the system that we're in is one that is oppressive, so forth and so on. As fate would have it, a few weeks later, I happened to be at the kitchen table with he and my grandmother, with him and my grandmother, and I saw these envelopes on the table. And I was an inquisitive kid, nosy. I picked it up and I said, Granddaddy, what is the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People? He said, that's a national civil rights organization. And I'm recruiting memberships for them. The membership was 50 cents, I believe, at that time. He said, son, one day, this organization is going to set us free. He said, they've got lawyers in New York and so forth and so on. So when you look at that kind of orientation that I heard him preach on Sundays about freedom, so forth and so on, he was painting on my blank slate, or writing on my blank slate, a kind of resistance attitude to racism and discrimination that I think served me well in 1960. Actually, he was an evangelist, so that he didn't actually have a church. Mm-hmm. He was always on the circuit preaching at different churches all over that part of Southwest Georgia and Northeast Alabama. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You might have been young enough that you wouldn't have known this, but I think that's right around the time that Ms. Baker was traveling around in that area doing membership drives. Do you have any idea if she might have come through there?
I don't know whether or not she came through there or not. That was 1941, 42. Was she with? She was with the NAACP at that time.
I've
yes.
I've seen a few flyers.
Yeah, she was with the
Southwest.
Right,
Georgia.
She was there. Come to think of it, she had two stints at the NAACP, I think, didn't she?
And well,
I think
different positions.
Right.
I can't remember what they call the first one. Maybe field secretary.
Yeah.
And then director
yeah.
of branches.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know whether or not she ever met my grandfather. She probably did, to be honest with you. But I mean, I was a little kid, you know. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
What kind of work did your grandfather do?
He was a farmer. He was sharecropper. He had 10 acres that he rented from some man that owned the property, and they would divide up in the fall, whatever. I don't know whether or not he ever broke even. Mm-hmm. I just know that he was a sharecropper. And I used to go to the field. I was too young to do any work, so I would go and watch him. I never forget an anecdote here. I had ventured down into the cornfield part of the 10 acres, and I ran into a rattlesnake. And, of course, I knew to run from a rattlesnake. So when I got back to the wagon, I said, Granddaddy, I just ran upon a rattlesnake down here. He said, I don't think they're in a rattlesnake. I said, I just ran upon one, Granddaddy. He said, I'm going down here, and if I don't find a rattlesnake, I'm going to smack your butt. I said, Granddaddy, you don't think the rattlesnake's going to wait for you to come down there, do you? Come on. He went down there. He didn't find a rattlesnake, but he did not beat me either, you know. But these anecdotes really do, I guess, make me feel good when I think about the man and what he did for me. And one of the things he used to tell me is that you need to always try to tell the truth when something comes up. It's easier to tell the truth than the lie, because when you lie, you got to remember the lie in order to not get caught in the lie. So just tell the truth, and it keeps coming out right. All those kind of things make a difference when you're young and coming up?
It must have been a real difficult experience then to have him pass and go on to Atlanta.
It was terrible. It was terrible. Mm-hmm. But I came here at 8 years of age, and I guess we can move on into Atlanta now. My mother was a member of Ebenezer Baptist Church. So I came in March, and they had the spring revival in April. And so Reverend King Sr. opened the doors of the church that first night that I went to the revival. My mother was in the choir. So when they opened the doors of the church, I got up and I went down and I joined. I could see my mother looking at me. I had not talked to her about it, and she had some concern, I could tell. So when we got on the bus to go home, she said, "You didn't tell me you were going to join the church." I said, "Well, we didn't talk about it." She said, "Well, do you know what you're doing?" I said, "Yes, I know what I'm doing." So she didn't say any more about it, but she was shocked that I did it at 8, because, you know, anyway. But while at Ebenezer, I was there from 45 until 54 when I went into the military. And I was in church. My mother, she took me to church almost every day in the week. I mean, that was something going on. Oh, Jesus. And when I went to the church, she had me at the YMCA. And I'll cover that later. But anyway, while I was there at the Ebenezer Baptist Church, Daddy King, Mrs. King were always asking me to lead something, head something. And that was when I formed something called the Ebenezer Youth Organization that's still running down there now. I was the first chairman and the organizer of it. But that's also when I met his children. You know, A.D. and I had a paper route together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And of course, Emil was a little older than A.D., and I always knew that he was going to be a great preacher, because on Thursday nights, while my mother was there rehearsing downstairs with the choir, he'd be upstairs practicing his preaching. You know, just his dad was a pastor, so he could get the key. So Martin King, it's almost like he never played. He was always serious.
So he would be in there, you know. So
practicing, every, practicing,
yeah.
Practicing.
So did you ever offer him any feedback?
No, I didn't. We were just friends, that's all, you know. And I guess it probably helped. My name was the same as theirs, and so they knew who I was, you know. And that may have been the reason why they kept asking me to do things, so they had the same name. But anyway, that served me well later on during the movement, which I'm sure we'll talk about later on.
So it sounds like you were really much, very much immersed in these black institutions coming up in Atlanta.
Yes, yes. The Butler Street YMCA, in addition to the church, my mother took me down to the Butler Street YMCA when I was 8, before I even started to school, because she kept me out of school for several months because I was 8, but I was promoted to the 5th grade, and she felt I was going too fast, and so she had me sit at home from March until September. She said, because if I let you go, you might get promoted to the 6th grade and you'd just be 9. She said, "I'm not sure, I want to do that." So I had to sit home and what have you. But she also went down to the Butler Street YMCA, an historic Y that's now closed, believe it or not, but it was organized in 1890-something. She asked me to go down there, and I went. But what I just learned as I've been writing for my dissertation, I interviewed a man who's 85 years old. And I interviewed him because he was around Atlanta during that time, and I knew he was around the Y. His name is Mr. Eugene Thomas. Very lucid man, retired from the public school system. So I went to see Mr. Thomas, and I said, "Mr. Thomas, let me talk to you about my tenure at the Y, and also about Atlanta and the environment in the 40s, when you were an adult here." He said, "Okay." And we talked about all of that, but he said, but specifically talk about you, He said, I was there. He was an assistant to Mr. J.D. Winston, who was the director of the What Boys Division at that time. And so he told me that my mother came down there to see Mr. Winston in 1945 to tell her that she had a son who was coming into Atlanta from Arlington, Georgia. And she wanted me to come down there and wanted him to look out for me while I was down there. And that I should not let me leave there until 6 o'clock, because by that time she would have a chance to get home from her job as a maid. And Mr. Winston agreed to that. I did not know until I talked to Mr. Thomas that she came down there another time just to see how things were going and wanted to know from Mr. Winston if I was a good boy or a bad boy, because if I was a bad boy, she was going to whip my behind right there. I said, okay. I didn't know any of this stuff. It was all done behind my back, but I guess for my benefit, though. You know, those were some good times. Young people could, when we parents were not necessarily afraid of molestation of their children by people. Like nowadays, you got to watch out because you don't know what's going to go on. But during those days, people trusted one another. People looked out for the kids. And then those things had a tremendous bearing on you. So I grew up in the Butler Street YMCA, and I left there in 54. I was there I was there so much until they hired me. They hired me down there. at 50 cents a day. And I was just around just helping. I was a little helper around there. Yeah. And I knew I had gotten paid 50 cents a day for basically just kind of being there, picking up towels, you name it. And I said, Mr. Thomas, it just dawned on me. Where did you all get the budget to pay me 50 cents a day? He said, there was no budget. I said, well, where did the money come from? He said, we all chipped in 50 cents a piece. I mean, in other words, he said, we paid it. The senior staff put together a little money to pay this little 8, 9, 10-year-old kid. I was shocked that that had happened, but it happened. Dr. Crosby, I believe when you boil it all down, you look at all these things, God was preparing me for 1960. Because while I was at the YMCA for all those years, I ran into all the movers and shakers in Atlanta, in the black community. They were down there playing bridge. And I'm the little kid around there watching them play bridge, and I learned table tennis, and I taught a lot of them how to play table tennis. I was like a little mascot that was always around. So when the movement thing, when Greensboro erupted, as I reflect back now, I had been prepared for leadership of the movement in Atlanta. Because in order to make it work, you had to find a way to merge the town and the gown. And because I had met so many people at the Y that knew me from when I was a child, that helped me a great deal when I called them to ask, can I get your help? One more thing that I think is important in my development. I went to my mother was a maid, so she couldn't pay my tuition in Morehouse. I had gone over there on a partial scholarship, but didn't have enough to really have a full scholarship. So I decided to do something that I had said I'd never do, which is to go in the military. And I went into the Navy, and I went there because the Navy offered me a chance to come in on what they call a kiddie cruise. That would be 3 years. If you went in before you're 18, you get out the day before you're 21. And so I went in just before I was 18, got out in 3 years. While I was in the Navy, I ran into some of the most virulent races that you could ever encounter under the umbrella of the United States of America. When I was in boot camp, I was the educational petty officer for my 80-some guys who was in my group. My job was to teach them the 3 hours in order for them to graduate after 11 weeks. when I finished, I was in charge of about 20 people who went to the USS Erskine aircraft carrier in California. So I had all the records and everything. So when I got there and we saluted the officer the day we came on board, they sent us down to something called the X-1 division. That's the orientation division for 2 weeks. So when we finished the orientation division, two-week tenure, they then gave us all a billet. They all gave us a job. So I was the only black person of the folks who went, 19 white people plus me. Every last white person got a good job. By that I mean either as a yeoman, which is the same as a secretary, air controlman, fire controlman, you name it, those jobs that were, that you had some relationship, those jobs, to a civilian career, except two people in the group. Two of us were sent to the deck force to chip paint and mop and scrub and you name it. That was me. I had the highest GCT in the group, and the young guy from Kentucky had the lowest GCT. Now, I knew all that stuff because I was in charge of the records, you follow me? So the black guy and the white guy with the lowest GCT get assigned to the deck force. It's too late to get out by that time because I'm there. So I go down to begin my work chipping paint. Well, that wasn't enough. I got a call after I was down there about a month I was going to be assigned to another job. And this time I was assigned the job of cleaning the head. Now, the head was the restroom, was for 200 people who worked in the deck force on the aircraft carrier, okay? That's a janitor's job, basically, you follow me? So I went up there, and I remember something Dr. Mays said when I was a freshman. He said, when you go to Morehouse College, you need to do the very best that you can, and you need to do whatever job you do, do it better than anybody else other than God. And if it's your fate to be a lawyer, be the best lawyer, be the best preacher, best doctor. But if fate falls upon you where you have to be a ditch digger, be the best ditch digger that's ever been born. And I said, well, mine wasn't ditch digging, but it was cleaning up this restroom. So I said, well, let me take his admonition. And so I went out and I requisitioned paint, brass polish, you name it. And I turned the place into a very nice looking, well-lit, bright bathroom. So therefore, I only had to work maybe a half hour in the morning, a half hour in the afternoon after lunch. The rest of the time, I could read books. And I want you to know that what I had created was so appealing until a third-class petty officer put in a petition to bump me out of that job and put me back in the deck force.
So you made cleaning the bathroom look like a good job.
Any job that you would make in the South, it seems to me, that some whites would say, you know, I'd rather have that job, put that nigger out of here. And so that's what happened to me. So then I applied for dental technician school. But you had to have 2 years left. So they sent me a acceptance, 1 year, 11 months, and 29 days to go on my enlistment, which meant then that I had to sign up for an additional year. I said, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to put up with this. As fate would have it, the dispersing office put out a request for someone to become a dispersing clerk striker, a dispersing clerk trainee. And I applied for it. The division officer called me down to have an interview. His name is Ensign J.C. Claren, K-L-A-R-E-N. Claren asked me, why did I apply? And I told him I thought I could do the job. Can you type? I said, no, but I can learn how to do it. He said, well, and I'm paraphrasing now, he said, we don't want any Negroes down here. All the folks in here from the South, you know, it would just not be the thing. I said, well, wait a minute, now my parents pay taxes too now, just like their parents. Yeah, but it wouldn't work. I went to see the chaplain on the ship and told him about my plight. He said, did they do that? I said, yes, they did. He said, I don't believe it. I said, yes, they did. He didn't do a thing but just take the notes down. So I'm now back on the deck for us, and I decided that I would ask the division officer who was over the deck for us for an appointment. And that was a Lieutenant J.G. Horn, H-O-R-N-E, from Louisiana. I've forgotten the name of the town in Louisiana. And I went in and I told him the same thing that I told the chaplain. J.G. Horn listened to me. He said, come with me. He took me down to that same ensign who said that they didn't want me down there. Lieutenant J.G. Horn said, Mr. King tells me, that was, first of all, he said, Mr. King. I was surprised at that. He said, Mr. King said, and he told him the story. Is that true? He said, well, they don't want him down here. He said, so then it is true. Yes. He said, if his name is not in the plan of the day, tomorrow, being transferred down here, I'm going to go to the Chief of Naval Personnel and get your commission. He said, Mr. King, come on, let's go. The next morning, my name was in the plan of the day to be transferred down because of that white man down in Louisiana who stepped up to the plate to tell another white man, you're wrong.
Had you had interactions with him before?
Nope. Saw him all the time, but he was speaking, I'd speak, but never. That was nothing. See, you had a hierarchy.
Yeah.
You had the division officer, then you had a chief, petty officer. Then you had a first class, and you had a second class, and you had some third classes. So I was just a poor old seaman, you know, down here. So no, they didn't really talk to you unless they wanted to see you. I mean, they'd pass by and be friendly, but the point is you had no contact with them per se.
Do you think he did that because he had some sense of you? Or didn't?
No, I think he did because I think he thought it was fair and not right.
Yeah.
Now, I may be wrong, but I'm just telling you what happened. That's how I got down there. So when I got there, the guys wouldn't even talk to me. They were just angry, I guess, because I had broken the color line on that ship. One guy named Welty Wolf from Seattle, Washington, was in that group, and he was a guy who had been to dispersing school. One day he came over to me and he said, Lonnie, I've been there for weeks now, nobody taught me anything. I was just there. He said, I went to dispersing school and said, are you willing to stay on board ship and learn this stuff? I said, yeah. He said, I'll teach you. He said, but it's going to require, he said, you can take the exam. The next exam is in November. This is August of 55, I'm sorry, August of 55. So I started studying all the books, and then another guy named John Bloom from Tempe, Arizona, who also was in that group, joined in to help Wolf. He wanted to teach me how to type. Make a long story short, I took the exam with four other white guys for third-class petty officer in November. When the results came back, I was the only one who passed. So all of a sudden now, the guy that they didn't want down there now is one of the bosses. Revolution down there, okay? So I stayed there, and I went on, and I became, you know, staff sergeant, you know, DK5, and then I got out. I was talking to a good friend of mine by the name of Everett Render, R-E-N-D-E-R, who was my manager when I was a prize fighter in the Navy. And I told Everett Render in the forecastle, in the front of an aircraft carrier, they call it a forecastle, in Hong Kong, China. Everett was getting out of the Navy, and I was going to be in a little bit longer than he. He said, well, Lonnie, why don't you come to San Francisco, because I'm going to be working for Pacific Bell, and I can get you a job there. I said, no, I'm going back to Atlanta, finish Morehouse. He said, why are you going back down there? I said, Everett, there's going to come a time, I believe, when we're going to throw off the shackle of segregation down there, and I want to be there. I told him that in 1957. I got you, makes sense. Okay. So, when I came back to Morehouse in 57, I played football and so forth and so on. And therefore, I got to know a lot of people.
Can I interrupt for a second?
Sure.
When you went into the Navy, did you have any expectations going in about what kind of environment it would be in terms of racism or opportunity?
Well, I think my mother had more than I. We remember now, my mother had to sign for me to go in because I was not 18. And so when we went down to the recruiting office, my mother said to the recruiting officer, I don't want my son to become a seagoing busboy, was what she said. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what that was, what she meant. And so she explained that she didn't want me going to sea, and all I was going to be doing is being a steward's mate serving the officers. so they didn't make me a steward's mate. They made me a deck force person, okay? Because she told the officer that she was signing those forms for me to go in with the premise that he would not be a seagoing busboy. So she knew what I was going into. And she thought she was protecting me. I guess she did. She kept me from being a seagoing busboy. But how about a janitor? She didn't put that in. But anyway, when I came back, I played football. I played first string fullback for Morehouse and ran a few touchdowns for them. And that meant then that I knew a lot of people at Morehouse and Spelman, which served me well later. So when the Greensboro Four sat down on February the 1st, I was reading the newspaper at Yates and Milton, and I went to my good friend Joseph Pierce and said, Joe, why don't we organize and do something here? And he read it. He said, okay, let's do it. And I said, let's go talk to this guy over here. I said, I met him in 57. He was a Time magazine intern when he was in high school, so he should be able to write. We need to have somebody who can write well with us to tell the story as we organize. And that guy was Julian Bond. And so we went to see him, and Julian was reluctant at first, but he finally agreed to sign on. And so the three of us then began to organize.
Did he explain his reluctance?
He basically just said that he thought it ought to happen. Somebody else would probably do it, but he didn't want to get involved necessarily at that point. But I just kind of pressured him just a little bit, and it didn't take too much. I mean, intellectually, he understood it, but I think I might have caught him off guard at the time I talked to him. But when you read his family, his dad's history, you could realize that his dad was a tremendous scholar and wrote a lot of great things about civil rights. Mm-hmm. So I think that it was in his blood, but I think I kind of surprised him in the beginning with that. But we held our first meeting of the students at Morehouse Sale Hall Annex. About 20-some people came. And
I'm really interested in, how these meetings were organized, who you went and talked to, and how you...
Well, I actually started with the people that I knew best. They were football players, mm-hmm. Who were blocking for me on Saturdays. I got a lot of them to come. I got people from Clark College to come. James Felder, who was the head of the SGA over there. But most of them were from Morehouse, because that was my base. I learned at that time how extensive the president's apparatus was. Because I guess within a matter of a day or two, I got this call from she came down to Yates and Milton. Mrs. Hill was Dr. Mays' secretary. I don't know her first name, but her name was Hill. She came into the place where I was, and she did this. She said, "Mr. King, I'm Mrs. Hill. Dr. Mays wants to see you at 3 o'clock in the conference room at Harkness Hall." And she also told Julian and Joe Pierce. And I said, "Boy, we're in trouble now."
They knew exactly who it was. Not just something that was brewing, but
yeah.
Exactly who it was.
Yeah. They had good spies. Anyway, when we got in the room, all of a sudden, all of the SGA people from the other place, other schools were there, along with Julia and Joe Pierce and me. And so Dr. Clement, who was the chairman, Dr. Rufus Clement, the president of AU, was chairman of the meeting and of the Council of College Presidents. Dr. Clement said, well, he laid out that they knew what was going on and they talked about the evils of segregation and what have you, but the thesis that they used was that you need to let the NAACP handle this. They're equipped to do it. They have the lawyers to do it. Your parents did not send you here to start a revolution. They sent you here to get an education. You can do the revolution later on. Dr. Mays, who was the second senior person, spoke next. He reiterated Dr. Clement's position. And also added that he was a life membership chairman of the NAACP, and he had spoken to Roy Wilkins before the meeting, and they're going to provide any legal assistance that we need. Dr. Manley from Spelman echoed the same position. Dr. Brawley, the president of Clark, made what I consider to be the most asinine comment of anybody that was made that day. He said that if we went downtown to sit in, that we would embarrass him. I couldn't believe the man said that, but that's what he said. And then we came to Dr. Harry V. Richardson, who was the president of the Interdenominational Theological Center. Dr. Richardson waited about a good 10 seconds before he said anything. Classic Baptist preacher, I guess. And he began, and I'm paraphrasing, "I think the students are right." We all looked around because he had broken the commonality that I think was agreed upon by the presidents before the meeting. And he went on to knock it out the park. And he, in effect, said that it was time for a change. It's going to be risky. But he said, "I have a PhD. I'm the president of a major institution of higher education. I can go downtown and spend my money to buy clothes. I can buy anything I want to buy down there. But if I want to stop in the nice restaurant to have a lunch, I can't go in there." He said, "There's nothing wrong with that picture." And he said, "I support the students." I could see the president get upset. But before they could really settle down, Dr. Frank Cunningham, the president of Morris Brown College, spoke up and said, "I agree with Dr. Richardson." I knew then that we had him split up. And he made a very eloquent speech. He was a philosopher. Then Dr. Clement, I guess while he was thinking, he said, "Well, who's going to speak for the students?" So everybody looked at me because I was the agitator. So I started speaking and I laid out the premises. This thing is growing. The AU Center has always been a citadel of learning for African Americans, and there's no reason why we should be left behind. So forth and so on. When I finished, Dr. Clement said, we still think you ought to let the NAACP handle this thing legally. However, why don't you write a manifesto and tell the public why you were doing this? He said, you're from the AU Center. We need to have an intellectual document that you draft, not us, but you draft, that would set forth why you were doing whatever it is you might do later on.
What you might do.
Well, I always knew that that was from his perspective. He was playing chess with us. In other words, if you're going to still do this, let me make a chess move here and have you write something. And if you get all caught up in writing, events might overtake you, and then you just be the philosophers of the movement as opposed to activists in the movement. That was a part of what I think he said. He also said, in the full-page ad in all the papers, I will raise the money, and I'll get it all done. I accepted the challenge, and I appointed Rosalind Pope to edit it. I asked Julian to join her, Charles Black to join her. I think it was Morris Dillon, I believe, I asked to join. But the bottom line is that all these people I knew had been English majors in some way or another and would write a great document. And Rosalind is so brilliant until it's just unreal how brilliant she is. But you never know it unless you just sit down and talk to her one day. She's just not the kind that goes around and brag. But that document was written. Well, actually what happened is Rosalind called me the night before we were supposed to go back and show it to the presidents for their approval. She called me and she said, Lonnie, the committee you appointed hadn't done a thing. She said, Julian got me some data from A Second Look. She said, but the others haven't done anything. I said, Rosalind, it's showtime. We've got to have a document for the presidents in the morning. Write the damn thing. So she said, okay. And so she wrote it, typed it at Dr. Zinn's house, Howard Zinn. And I think Julian may have typed it, but they used Zinn's typewriter to get it done. And so when we read it, when the president saw it the next day, they were very pleased at the document. They might have made one or two comments. By and large, about 99% of what Rosalind had written, everybody agreed with. And it was published. Clement had raised $12,000 to pay for the stuff. And it cost about $4,000 in all. He had $8,000 left there for our benefit if we needed it. And it was published in the Atlanta Journal, the Atlanta Constitution, and I believe the Atlanta Daily World. Dr. Clement, I think, told me that Mr. Scott, who headed the Atlanta World, black newspaper, wanted cash up front before he would run it. but the white papers sent him a bill. He was upset about that. But anyway, that publication, though, ended up being reprinted in the New York Times, full page, free. The Nation magazine ran it on, we did it on the 9th of March. The Nation magazine ran it, full page ad in their magazine on the 2nd of April, 1960. The Harvard Crimson ran it. Senator Jacob Javits had it read into the congressional record, and it's there for posterity right now. And it's been used all around the world by a lot of different people. I guess the invitation is, I happen to be doing some research work here recently on this area, in the area, and lo and behold, I found a document that had been written by Miles College students in 1962. And it basically was nothing but the appeal for human rights, retitled This We Believe. And Atlanta had been taken out and Birmingham had been put in. Yeah. I told Rosalind, I said, Rosalind, invitation is the best form of flattery.
Yeah. Yeah.
But anyway, but we started this movement, and I've explained a lot there in those documents. Now, should I give you the narrative about what happened, or are you going to use the narrative?
Can I ask you a few questions?
Sure. Mm-hmm. May 17th, okay. The boycott. I'm trying to figure out, do you want me to ask me those questions or should I just keep talking? Because I can talk on and on about it.
I know. Well, you know, there's so much. In some ways, I'd like to have you, you know, keep going, tell the narrative, and then come back. But so when the president brought you all in, and it was you and Joe Pierce and Julian and the student body presidents.
And vice president and a secretary, I think. Three from each school.
So three from each school.
Right.
Did they decide to get the student government?
The presidents did that. We didn't.
Yeah. Okay. And because I know I was talking to a few people, and they said that, you know, some of the presidents were really never involved other than signing the document, and that one of them chose not to sign it, which is how Marianne...
Oh, you mean the president of the Student Government Association? Yes. Yes, that's true. The guy named Hickman,
okay,
who was from Macon, Georgia, had a Methodist... I think the white Methodist in Macon had given him a scholarship to come to Morris Brown. And so he was afraid he'd lose his scholarship, and so Marianne signed it in his as a secretary.
When so you know, out of that, you appointed the committee to try to write this, and Rosalind Pope ends up doing
most of it. Yeah.
And then I know at a certain point there's a committee on appeal. You know.
That started right after that.
And so how did you, you know, I'm very interested in who emerged as the leaders. And how that happened. You know, these people who are in official leadership positions as athletes or student government, are there people that just emerged, or is it a combination?
Well, let me see, can I answer that this way? Once we published the appeal, at about the time we published the appeal, the best way I can answer this, there was a rump group headed by Dr. Lonnie Cross, who was a PhD in mathematics at AU. He took his students down there to sit in that Richards before we could get there. Yeah.
I've never heard that.
There's documentation.
Oh, no, I'm
yeah. Yeah. So what happened is that it was, but the campus was buzzing with all this activity, so they knew what was going on. So he wanted to get there and put his name down before we got there. My position was that all the schools should come together to form a coalition called the Committee on Appeal for Human Rights, which we later on did after it was published. But prior to that, he had pulled this little sit-in down there with his students, maybe five or six of them. And so I contacted Dr. Clement and raised with him the perspective that we couldn't afford to have Clark going down one day, AU another day, Marsh Brown another day. I said, that is a divide, and that's a divide and conquer if ever I've seen one. I said, because all you're going to do is have the merchants say, well, who do I negotiate with, Morris Brown or Morehouse? I said, we need to have a one voice. I said, what's the common denominator here? The common denominator is that we're all African Americans or Negroes. We're all being subjected to the same kind of discrimination by the same institutions downtown. So to go down there now with these divided voices makes no sense. Clement agreed with me. He called an all campus meeting down at Ware Hall, EA Ware Hall, which is on the campus. I had all the AU students come to hear him and me. So Dr. Clement gave the exposition as to why the meeting was being held. And he argued that we ought to be together. That's the position that we've taken, and then the presidents agree with that. We ought to do it as one body. And he was saying to Dr. Cross, it is counterproductive for you to take your class down and do this. So I got to say to all of you, don't do that. Let's do it in some kind of organized fashion. And so he said, Lonnie, would you explain to them what you're going to try to do? And so I gave the exposition. Dr. Cross, when I finished, jumped up and challenged me. And he challenged the right to, as a professor, to take his class downtown, and he wasn't going to listen to any student, okay? So Dr. Clement said to him, "Dr. Cross, would you sit down?" So Cross sat down. And then I spoke on, then Cross jumped up again. So Clement said, "Dr. Cross, would you sit down?" And Cross tried to get a little bit subordinate with him. Clement said, "Dr. Cross, sit down." I knew then that Cross had been fired, okay? Because you don't do that to those guys during that period of time. So Cross' contract was not renewed in May. So I knew he was dead as a result. But Clement backed us, backed me and us, all of us, about the idea of pulling a coalition together. And so after the appeal was published, we sat down in that same conference room and decided that every school would have 3 representatives on this policy council. And then the 18 members would pick a chairperson. And then that chairperson then that school from which the chairperson comes can send another person. So I was chosen to be the original chairman, founding chairman, I guess you would call it. And so therefore another person from Morehouse could be added to it. So it ended up being Don Clark, he's the president of the SGA, Julian Bond, and Albert Brinson, who I think he was the vice president of the SGA. But that's only from Morehouse, of course.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, that's really interesting. So at that point, President Clement, although he was trying to slow you down initially, so is this a strategic decision that this is going to happen, and if it's going to happen, this is the best way for
I think so, happen? Yes. I think he realized that the events had overcome their authority, okay? Mm-hmm. They were concerned about losing their tax-exempt status. That was a legitimate concern. I did not realize how legitimate it was until recently when I started doing research. The governor of Georgia, Ernest Vandiver, when the appeal was published, said that that document could not have been written by college students anywhere in America. It had to be written by students, by somebody from Moscow. And what I learned is that he instructed Eugene Cook, who was the Attorney General, to check on the 501c3 status of all the HBCUs. So I'm going to pick up the documents on that. But the bottom line is that they were under siege, which we didn't know about at the time. They were risking their 501c3 status. At least the state part of it, okay? Mm-hmm. And but you know, there must have been a serious conflict in the minds of the college presidents. When you think about what Dr. Richardson said, with all this training, Clement from Wisconsin, mm-hmm. Mays from Bates and University of Chicago, all these people, all this education, and there was a ceiling. You know, you could just go so far. And the duality on the part of the folks who ran the system, that duality didn't bother them at all. That's just the way it's supposed to be in this culture. Dr. Crosby, I see this whole thing as akin to, that period as akin to a volcano. In the sense that it was simmering below the surface, all these things, the different I guess you would say different systems up under the surface were going on that were dangerous, powerful. But you couldn't see it because the culture was such that you hid the oppression. It was there, but you hid how you felt about it. And I think that when the young men sat down in Greensboro, that was the catalyst. That was the that was the one thing that caused the volcano to erupt. And I don't see any other way you can answer it, because within 120 days, 70,000 black kids were raised in sand all over the South. Because segregation was ubiquitous, it existed everywhere. And so I think that you know, that along with the Second World War, where a lot of veterans came back, and when you think about it, just as my daddy, veterans of the Second World War had children that were going to school at that time. And where could you get a better set of shock troops, people who were in school, they were away from their hometown, most of them, and therefore the normal oppressive means for keeping niggers in that place, you could not employ it, because if the kid is from Miami, how are you going to get folks in Miami to fire his mama, you know, or the other place? So, but they tried it now, because if you go back and look at what happened during that time, every time we got arrested, they put our name, rank, and serial number in the paper. Even in my case, they put down I lived at 22175 Gordon Road, apartment number 2A, just to make sure you knew where he was. My mother was scared to death, but was supportive. Let me tell you two things about my mother that I think are important for this. When between March the 15th and May 17th of 1960, I was having some difficulty getting people organized in terms of numbers beyond the 30, 40, or 50. And I knew I needed more than that in order to make this work. And so I was talking to my mother about it. I said, Mama, I need more people. She said, you've been all in? I said, I've been to the campus, but I need more people. She said, well, people are afraid. She said, you know. She said, go over to Spelman. She said, the ladies will probably know who you are because of your football stuff. And see, can't you organize and get the Spelman women behind you? Because if you get the Spelman women behind you, the Mohawks men are going to come because of the girls. The Clark folks will come, Marsh Brown. And so as fate would have it, you see, Dr. Crosby, when you go back and reflect on this thing, you said, you know, there's a divine hand in all of this. Because let me tell you what else happened. I got a telephone call from Dr. Manley. Dr. Roy Wilkins was coming to town to speak at Spelman around the 1st of April. And he wanted me to come and present the students' view. The issue was, should we go back to class, basically? So Manley and Wilkins, they were taking the affirmative position. And they wanted me to come and argue the negative position. And so I was scared to death. Yes, it's imposing to go and debate a man with international reputation like Roy Wilkins. Suave, well-educated, been at this stuff for 30-some years. So here we are, three of us up there on the stage, and the place is packed with all ladies from Spelman. So Dr. Manley introduced Dr. Wilkins, and Wilkins knocked it out the park. I mean, he was smooth as silk. Oh, God. But I remember I had a course in public speaking at Spelman, interestingly enough. And the guy, Dr. Cothran, said, if you think you're being outgunned in a debate, learn how to damn them with faint praise. He said, give them their due, and then you do your however. And so I used my public training that I got from him, and when I got up, I praised Mr. Wilkins like you wouldn't believe. But it was all true now. All the stuff that they had done, I mean, I laid it out. It was almost like I was making his speech all over again. But then I pivoted. And I made the speech about the time had come. And I went on and I used an alliteration technique on that. And I ended by saying, Mr. Wilkins, if not now, when? And if not us, who? And I sat down. And the girls went, wow. Mr. Wilkins did this. He said,
He and I,
I guess you would say, on the same page. And we had some other dealings later on. But those ladies came, and the rest is history. I mean, on May 17th, when we had that big march here, we had almost 4,000 people going downtown. We emptied Spelman's campus and Morehouse's campus.
I wanted to ask you about that. I'm so glad you brought that up. Well, you know, one of the things I wanted to ask you is, because when I was doing this research, it's just preliminary, but one of the things I'm very interested in is women's role in all of this.
Okay.
And so, of course, Atlanta's a wonderful place to look at that, because, you know, there seems like great participation. And so...
But it's unheralded. It has not been written. Okay, go on.
That's true. That's true. Well, we can talk about that sometime. So I don't know enough to know whether this is actually accurate, but impressionistically, it looks like there's maybe a disproportionate number of Spelman participants relative to some of the other campuses.
Absolutely.
Is that true?
Absolutely. I have identified 169 Spelman ladies who actually either went to jail or were out there risking things. Now, there were a whole lot more than that involved in the picketing and stuff. But those who actually went to jail, I think it was 169. No, Morehouse didn't even come close to that. Morehouse would be number two. Clark would be number three. Marsh Brown, number four. But Spelman, my mama was right. The Spelman ladies will make it happen. If they get behind you, they'll make it happen.
Do you have an explanation for why they were so responsive? I mean, obviously you gave this great talk, but you could do that at Morehouse, right? Or one of the other campuses.
I couldn't carry as many men as I could carry women at that time.
Yeah.
I'm just going to be honest with you.
Yep.
Women don't have something else. At Morehouse, I think I ran into a lot of jealousy from other young men who position was, you know, Lonnie was not elected president of the SGA, so why are we following him? You know, but no one else was risking their life but me, you know, but nevertheless,
right.
I think that was a part of it. I think it was male jealousy, some of it. We're talking about Morehouse Spelman participation. The women at Spelman, I think, they were the backbone of the movement, in my opinion. Women don't get hung up on who's the leader. If there's a job to be done and they want to do that job, they will get involved. They don't get caught up about who's doing it. Also, women don't mind following a man. I mean, that's kind of the way it is. The husband is the head of the house, and they don't get upset about that, okay? And I think that's one of the things that really was very, very helpful on that. But we're now in May of 1960. So I was invited to come and speak to the state NAACP. And so when I spoke to them, I announced that we were going to march on May 17th to the Capitol to commemorate the Brown decision that had been made 6 years earlier on May 17, 1954. I did not know that there was a reporter there from the Atlanta Constitution Journal. The following morning, it was headlines. You know, student leader announces massive march on the Capitol. The town went wild. Mind you now, they were still buzzing from the appeal for human rights and all of us going to jail and all that kind of stuff. So they knew something was happening. Well, Governor Vandiver called out the state patrol. They surrounded the Capitol, almost arm to arm with billy clubs and dogs to keep us from coming down to the Capitol. So I had asked the students to meet me in front of the library that morning at 10 o'clock, and they did. thousands of them. So before we marched off, Miss Hill, same lady, I see her coming. I knew Mays wanted to see me. So she, and so I told John Mack, who was my co-chairman, to keep him busy while I go see what Dr. Mays wants. And so I went up there, and so when I got there, it was Mays and his wife, Miss Sadie Mays. So Mays said that he had just spoken to Chief Jenkins, Herbert Jenkins, who was the chief of police, and that all the state troopers are down there with their biddy clubs and what have you, and there are whites who are gathering around, and it looks like it's going to be a big mob mess down there. And Jenkins emphasized that his jurisdiction ends at the Capitol. He's not in charge of those state troopers. The governor is. So he couldn't protect us.
Can I ask you, is he saying that because he can't and he's issuing a warning, or is he just
asking me to not, asking don't come because you might get hurt today.
And so is he concerned about you getting hurt?
I think that Jenkins was a part of, he was the police arm of the power structure in Atlanta. Atlanta has a reputation of being the city too busy to hate. It would not have been good for business if some students got beaten up in Atlanta, okay? So they lose some money. That's all it was about. It's not about love for the students. It's about love for money. That's right. So Dr. Mays asked me not to go. I got to give these people credit. They never ordered me to do anything. They would let me know how they felt. And they gave me a chance to respond. And so when he gave me all the reasons why we shouldn't do it because of the risk of danger, I said, well, Dr. Mays, let me take you back to a speech you made when I was a sophomore. I said, your speech was entitled, Never Sacrifice a Principle for Peace. Do you remember that? He said, yes.
He couldn't say anything else, could he?
I said, you're asking me to sacrifice this principle of ending segregation because I might get killed. Therefore, in order to have peace, I got to leave it alone. He said, Mr. King, where are you going to end up? I said, at Wheat Street Baptist Church. He said, Sadie and I will be there. That was the end of it. So I went back to speak to the students, and I did not know that Mays followed me until I read his book here recently, Born to Rebel. Mm-hmm. I happened to be reading the book, and I went to that, and I got to that section. He had followed me back, and he heard me tell the students, which he describes in his book, that there were people downtown wanted to hurt us. And this is a nonviolent movement. If you cannot take the blows, don't go. If you cannot afford to be spat on, don't go. And I went through an alliteration of things that we only want people who are willing to be nonviolent as a tactic. I'm not asking you to be nonviolent in your life, just as a tactic. And when I finished my speech, not one of those 3,000 plus kids said that they wanted to back out. And Mays describes that in his book, that I didn't even know he had followed me down there until I read his book. But he said in his book, he knew then that I had matured, was the way he put it.
So what is he suggesting?
Well, I think before then, Mays probably thought I was precipitous. Mm-hmm. I had considered all the factors involved, the harm that might come to the students. I think it was only at that point that he realized that I was very serious about this. Mm-hmm. And I had a lot of folks behind me. Now, I tell you, Dr. Crosby, if I did not have thousands of students backing me, I couldn't have done it.
Absolutely.
See? Because I don't care how good your cause is, if you don't have any followers, you just whistling Dixie. But anyway, we went down there on May 17th, that day, and we marched down, and there are a lot of pictures around about that. So Chief Jenkins, aforementioned, got out of his patrol car and started walking with me down at the corner of Mitchell Street and Walker Street that comes right in there. And so the two of us are just walking along, and he said, "It's going to be dangerous at the Capitol." I said, "Yes, I know. Dr. Mays told me you all talk." He said, "Well, I think you ought not to do this." I said, "Well, Chief, keep talking to me." I said, "But I think we have to do it." So we walked up until we got to Spring Street and Mitchell, which is where the new post office, the new Russell building is now. So I said, "Chief, if you give me a direct order as the chief law enforcement officer of the city at Peachtree Street, Whitehall Street, which is now Peachtree Street, I will turn." I said, "Because I'm not trying to get anybody hurt." I said, we are making a point. He said, "Okay, I'll do that." But let me tell you what was my thinking. Look at the environment. The Chamber of Commerce was against us. The white community was against us. The college presidents were scared. A lot of parents were scared. I said that if one student gets killed, then I'm playing into the arms of the enemies of what we're trying to do. I said, it is very clear now. They've never had this number of students to march on anything in this town. So I felt that I had made my point. Now, I know it's a little bit conservative, but I decided to err on the side of conservatism in order to save the movement, because I felt that if one person got beaten up by a billy club, that there would be forces that would be arguing to shut me down. And so I followed his orders after I gave him the suggestion.
This is a lot of responsibility.
It was hell. But then, as fate would have it, we had so many people marching until about the last 200, they got lost, and so they went on by the Capitol. And when they got there, I learned from the leader of that part, Charles Black, that it was awful. They didn't beat anybody, but they were heckled by all the white bystanders and the state troopers. It was a menacing thing. But I saw something else, Dr. Crosby, when I looked at all of this stuff lately. When you look at one of the photographs taken from the Capitol of that church across the street and all the folks that were out there, there were a number of young African American men who were not students. And I looked at that, I said, "Wait a minute. What's up here?" I can't prove this because the folks are dead now. But there may have been a black vigilante group in Atlanta that could have very easily stepped into the fray if there was any kind of a confrontation of a racial nature. I was shocked to see them, and I'll come back to that later on because I had another chance to see something similar to that, okay? Yeah, there may very well have been. If you want, put a pin right there, and I will just flash to tell you why I'm connecting them all. Mm-hmm. We started a boycott of this food stores mm-hmm. chains right after that, mm-hmm. and one of the stores that we went to was one place called Mann Brothers, over in West End, Atlanta. All the grocery stores hired blacks as janitors and maids and stock clerks, but never as cashiers or managers or assistant managers. Even though the business was 100% black, everybody was white who was in charge. So we pulled this boycott off over there, and it was a high wire act. So the newspaper in the West End had this front page editorial the Saturday before I came over there, because I announced that I was coming, all of us were coming, in red. They compared me to Hitler, and that I was coming over there to change things. When I got over there that Saturday, it was Charles Black, Frank Holloway, and me. There were about 300 whites across the street heckling us. There was a white guy, about 5'7", who was there by us with his hand in his pocket. And we put marched up and down with our picket signs and what have you. All of a sudden, this white guy lunged at me and doused an acid-like substance on me that burned like you wouldn't believe. I mean, it just burned my skin, my clothes, my shirt was destroyed, and I couldn't see. Terrible odor. It even impacted Frank Holloway and Charles, who were behind me. So they rushed me to the hospital, and I won't get into all of that except that, I went to two service stations, and the first service station would not let me get any water, but to leave, and then the second one did allow me to do that. Well, I learned later on that day that it was on the news, and the pool hall was now Martin King, but it was Hunter Street then, a black pool hall, emptied of all the men when they came over, and they ran to West End to see what was going on. And I think Atlanta was very close to having a racial conflagration during that period of time. But I think that cooler heads prevailed, and they were willing to allow these students to try to work this out. But I think that there was possibly a potential for Birmingham kind of violence here, but it would have been whites versus blacks like you wouldn't believe, okay? That's just, uh-huh.
Do you think that there were people who, spoke to some of the men and asked them to wait, or do you think they had a sense of, we're seeing how things go, how far it goes?
I'm not sure it was organized, but I would go with the latter point that you made. I don't know if anybody talking to them, because it just dawned on me. I mean, I knew about the pool hall emptying, but I had not seen those pictures of those fellows that were down there, because it was an all-white mob down there. And I was saying, in the middle of this all-white mob, what are these young black guys, like maybe 18 to 25, hovering around back there in the background? Just spectators? I mean, what's that all about? Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Where do you want me to go next?
Well, you mentioned before you went on that march on May 17th, talking to the students about, being prepared to be nonviolent. And I know in places like Nashville, they had really intense workshops. And in other places, they did, just don't hit back, kind of, and that there are very different approaches. Did you have any kind of training, or was it simply at any point in the process?
No, we did not. Our panel, our committee, took the view that nonviolence should be a tactic, mm-hmm. not a way of life. Mm-hmm. And therefore, there was no reason for us to go through all these. Now, I don't know what happened after I left, but I doubt very seriously if anyone actually ran any workshops. Nashville was known for having done that. I can't really speak to whether that's more effective than just people adopting it as a tactic, to be honest with you.
And I know that many people, not many, but I know that there were also places, not, and I don't even know if it's a lot, and I know SMCC did some of this, had workshops just on, so people have some practice in not responding. But it wasn't necessarily philosophical. It was still very practical, but it was just people can go through what it might be like just so that they're better prepared.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of people also did it, just don't hit back
yeah.
In sense.
Let me try to rush through a lot of what I've written. I've already covered some of this. Let me try to rush through. Let me talk about some institutions. The Atlanta Daily World, it was the oldest continuously running daily African-American newspaper in the country, possibly in the world, really. They were unalterably opposed to the movement and what we were trying to do. So Julian was basically our arm, and I had hired Julian that summer to write the publication called The Student Movement and You. We used the summer of 1960. May 17th was a big rally. Then it's exam times. Then people are gone. So we had to organize for the fall campaign. Mm-hmm. We had to also organize a boycott because we determined that we needed to boycott downtown Atlanta in order to make them come to an agreement to integrate. And we chose Richard's department store as the kingpin. All downtown, but Richard's for sure. In order to do that, then, we had to battle with the old line black leadership who felt that Richard's was a great store, even though they were segregated. But how do you get around that? 90% of African Americans in this town at that time were making a small amount of money. That 10% were teachers and doctors and what have you. But the bulk of the GNP was with the low income, $5 a day and coffee at people, okay? So we needed to then organize around our strength, and the strength was in the numbers. And I remembered when I took economics, Dr. E.B. Williams used to say that he'd much rather have the fast dime than the slow dollar. Or he said there are a whole lot more dimes than there are dollars, and there are a lot of folks who have dimes. And I used that along with another economics major named Dr. Hugo Scholar, who taught me about John Foster Dulles's policy about the domino theory. You know, the communists felt that in the Pacific Basin, if Korea falls, the rest of the basin will fall and it'll all be communist all the way over. Like dominoes, they'll fall in line. And so I took the position that Richard's department store was like a major domino. If we can knock down that domino piece, the rest will fall, because it was the largest store in the Southeast. So we took them on. I went down there in June of 1960 for a meeting I took some folks down. I took Dr. Zinn from Spelman, his daughter and his wife, myself, and I think Carolyn Long down there to the Magnolia Room. So they closed the Magnolia Room when we got there. And then Chief Jenkins, this guy, took me down to the to jail, not to be arrested, but to have a conference meeting with Dick Rich in his office. Chief Jenkins' office. So when I got there, Dick Rich was red as a beet, and he talked about how good he had been for Negro citizens. And he mentioned how he had supported the AU Center, and he was the first one to ever put Mr. and Mrs. on the names of his customers when they sent bills out. First ones give them charge plates, so forth and so on. And you need to go take your students back to class. And I gave him similar speech. You know, no, we have to. You have to change. So Dick Rich said to me, and I'm paraphrasing, if you bring your black ass down there again, I'm going to lock you up and throw the keys away, basically. And I said, Mr. Rich, I will be back in the fall. And when I come back, I'm going to bring thousands with me. He turned redder, and he told Chief Jenkins, I'm through. And he got up and walked out. And so they took me back to my office down on Auburn Avenue. The chief's people did. We're now writing the student movement in you. Mr. Scott, who owns Atlanta Daily World, is constantly editorializing against the movement. So we put out 20,000 leaflets per Sunday.
20,000.
To the churches, what have you. Building the movement. And one day in June 1960, in walks this man that I thought was white in my office. And I was a little edgy, tall, 6'3", 6'4", white guy who had gotten all the way back to my office. I didn't know whether he was going to kill me or what, you know. So I guess I must have looked apprehensive. You know, he sat down, and he had the Atlanta Daily World in his hands, and he said, my name is Kasut Hill. He said, now you're Lonnie King. I said, yes. He said, I own Hill Office Supplies. When he said that, I knew he had to be a black guy, okay, but he looked as white as anybody. So he said, this is a shame what this man is doing. He said, now he's doing this because he wants the white advertising. And he's selling out the cause of human dignity. He said, I own the rights to use the name The Atlanta Inquirer. He said, I've always wanted to start a newspaper. He said, I've got an editor. His name is William Strong. But I don't have any writers to help me. He said, if you can help me get people to handle circulation, he said, I will start it because I have an offset press. So the two of us came together and we agreed that I would stop the student movement in you, have Julian go and write along with John Gibson and James Gibson, his brother, and others to form the underbelly for that paper. And on the 31st of July, and you can find that in 1960, you may want to see that first issue.
I've seen it.
Oh, you have?
I have.
Okay, all right, all right, all right.
It's a wonderful paper.
Yeah, and it's still around.
I know.
You know, but that was started by Kasut Hill, myself, and the students, okay? It was not the folks that you read about. They came in later, but it was Mr. Hill, who has not been given his due, but I'm gonna give him his due, because the man did it when nobody else would do it. Kasut Hill, not Jesse Hill, Kasut Hill. Mm-hmm.
Had you had any sense of that? I mean, you must have been unhappy with the world.
Oh, no question about it.
Did you think about, I mean, it must have been wonderful to have that opportunity.
Well, we went to, a lot of things were happening at the same time. Mm-hmm. We went to Colonial stores and AMP stores right after that march, and asked for these cashiers, what have you. I got a telephone call from Mr. Scott telling me, C.A. Scott telling me, asked me would I come down to see him. So I went down to see him. And he proceeded to tell me that he's going to lose a $9,000 ad with the Colonial stores if I didn't stop the picketing. And so Mr. Scott, you were spitting all over me. Have you seen those folks who talk to you and they're mad and they start spitting? Well, he was spitting all over me. And so I'm just here listening to him beat up on me. So I said, Mr. Scott, you know, in every revolution, some people get hurt. But you don't call out the revolution because somebody might get hurt. I said, you know what? This is your time to get hurt. I'm not going to do it. He cursed me out, and I left. But the bottom line, he went to his grave hating me. And I guess I'm sure that when Mr. Hill started the newspaper later, that really got him, okay? Because we were able to get the real estate, the black real estate people, we got them to take their ads out of Mr. Scott's paper and put them in the Atlanta. So he really upset me, I guess.
You need somebody to taste your food for you.
Oh, boy, he was upset with me. He never changed. He was always like that to his death. But I think we whipped his behind badly, you know.
Two things real quick. Can you spell Mr. Hill's first name?
Capital K-O-U-S-S-E-T-T, I believe it is.
Okay.
Kasuth. He was the son of the first African American doctor in this town. Okay. Mm-hmm. And his wife was Ginger Hill, who was the head. She succeeded Whitney Young as the head of the Atlanta University School of Social Work.
And I noticed you wrote some columns.
Well, it was a combination of me and Julia.
Okay.
Yeah. I had several, but I think Julia may have written about a third of them. Because here was the deal. Dr. Crosby, when you're trying to run a movement as big as this thing was, you didn't have time.
A little busy?
I was a little busy. Plus, I worked all night at the post office, you know, on 6:30 to 3. So I didn't have time to write the article. I said, Julian, since I hired you, write my article when I'm not able to write it. And so he did that.
So did you all discuss what the focus
was? Oh, yeah. But that was, once we hired Mr. Carl Holman to come in and be the editor who took over from Bill Strong, we then tried to merge the message between what's on the editorial page and the cartoon. So if you didn't read the editorial, look at the cartoon and you still get the message. Mm-hmm. And I've got to give you a man by the name of Maurice Pennington, whom you may not have heard about. One of interest is one that I had forgotten that I had written. When we went to jail, and we'll talk about that later on, in October of 1960, mm-hmm. Martin King and I were in the same cell because we were the leaders of the movement, you know, per se. And I wrote an article, a letter from the Fulton County Jail. And I had forgotten that I had written the article until Dr. The doctor who's a school in the, he heads the School of Social Work at the University of Georgia. He wrote a biography of Don Hollowell.
Oh.
And he had all these newspapers. He said, let me send you a copy of what you said when you were in prison. But yes, I did write that. But also, Julian wrote some also, okay?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, there's some who say Julian Ghost wrote all of them. That's not true. Julian wrote mm-hmm. some of them, and I wrote some.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You said you wanted to say something about Maurice Pennington?
Yes, Maurice Pennington was, in my view, but for his race, he would have been acclaimed as one of the greatest illustrators or cartoonists in the country. At the time that Herb Lott was so big, Pennington was just as good. And I wish you could see some of his work. We're going to have a big exhibit in Atlanta, 18th and 19th of October at AU Library. And it'll be there for 30 days. And it's going to be there for 5 years, for 30 days. And we're going to show the as many of the artifacts of the movement as we can possibly pull together. It's going to be a big show, and if you get a chance, it'd be good to come back down for that because it's going to be a big deal. There's just a whole lot of stuff. It's a whole lot of stuff that people have not seen. We have 30-some cartoons from Mr. Pennington that are just out of sight that are going to be there, okay? Plus, he took 100-and-some pictures of the movement that also will be down there, action movement, action stuff.
There's some wonderful pictures from the Atlanta student movement.
Where did you see them?
I saw some of them in the AU archives.
Okay, yes, okay. Okay, well, that...
Some of them were from one of the anniversary committees that
you
were involved with.
Yes.
And you had some exhibits?
Yes. Well, we've just added to that exhibit. There's a lot more down there now. And by October, you're going to have, we'll have enough in there to go all the way around. Because there's stuff out there. It's just a matter of putting it all in one place. That's all.
Well, what I saw wasn't actually on display.
It was in boxes.
In the boxes, yeah.
Yeah, well, we're going to take stuff out of the boxes, and we're going to add more stuff to those boxes.
That's wonderful.
Mrs. Pennington is waiting to sign a document that I've prepared for her, where she's going to lend us a lot of his stuff for 5 years. I try to get it forever, but
yeah.
5 years is fine. You know,
that's a good start, right?
Yeah.
So I know there's a lot to talk about with Atlanta still, but can we take a detour and talk about the founding of SNCC?
Sure.
And, you know, I know the basic story, but I understand that you were present at the meeting in Raleigh, of course. Can, Can you tell me what you remember from the meeting?
Well, let me just say this to you, and this is not, this hasn't been written that many times, and you're going to get people who are going to be upset about it, but you ought to ask the Reverend Dr. Otis Moss. Mm-hmm. Whenever you talk to him, ask him about the founding of SNCC, because he was there. Once we got going in that spring, I recommended to our committee that I go meet with Martin King and see can I get him to pull together a meeting of all of us student leaders to form some kind of a South-wide organization. And Moss can attest to that. He was in that meeting. I called up Dr. King, and as you know, already know, I knew him, and so set up the meeting, and we went down there to see him. In the meeting was Ella Baker, Dr. King and me, and a couple other students whose memories have gotten kind of foggy, but I'm not even getting all of that. But I made the argument that the people that we were battling were highly organized. And I pointed out that we're battling a system that from Maryland to Texas, they're on the same page. And I cited the fact that when Virginia passed the anti-trespass laws, Maryland quickly passed them, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, Alabama, all around, all these states passed the same kind of law, almost word for word, like Alec today. I said, so the people that we're fighting, they're organized. And my point was that there is no known force that I've ever heard of in the world that where you had a revolution that was unorganized. The people that you're battling are organized, so you got to get organized to beat them. I said, the only example to that, Dr. King, might be the French Revolution, where they said the masses rose up. But when you look beyond the French Revolution, look into the inner core, you'll learn that there was an enlightened middle class back there that was pushing them. So Ella Baker, on the other hand, and this is contrary to what you've read, mm-hmm. opposed organizing this way. So it was a battle between her and me. She said that we needed to allow the movement organization to kind of flow up from the grassroots, and she used an Indian expression to, what's it called, Satyagraha? Yeah, she used that expression as the basis for her position. Martin King said, he agreed with me. And he said, I'm gonna put up $500 and I want you to, Ella, get a place for us to call this conference over Easter weekend. Of course, she finished Shaw, and so she got Shaw to host it. We were there. For whatever the reason, Ella and Martin parted company during that period of time. So by the time she got to the conference, she either was out the door or was about to go out the door. Yeah. My impression is that Ms. Baker, well, let me put it this way. A lot of African-American preachers are very chauvinistic. And Ms. Baker, from their perspective, did not know her place. And she was an outspoken person who would say what was on her mind. And that always got her in trouble with these preachers, all right? And I think that might have gotten her in trouble with Martin King, to be honest with you, okay? And if not him, some of his people around. So we were there. Dr. Albert Davis, who was the head of the Atlanta Medical Society, rented a brand new 1960 white Buick for us to go up there. There were six of us in the car who went from Atlanta to that conference. And I think Johnny Parham, who was also part of our group, flew in from some other place, but he was there too. My recollection is that it was Julian, Ben Brown, I think Mary Ann Smith, Marion Wright Edelman, and I believe it must have been Charlie Frank Lyles, L-Y-L-E-S, I think. He's a guy from Summerhill who went to Texas. But anyway, we all were there, and so SNCC was formed, as you well know. It was good to see 300 people roughly there under the same umbrella. Now, there are those who claim that Dr. King wanted SNCC to become a junior arm of SCLC. I don't want to doubt that he didn't aspire to that, but he never talked to me about that. And I don't know anybody else that he talked to about that. But there were those who felt that that's what he was trying to do. They may have evidence. I don't have the evidence. Because I honestly believe, Dr. Crosby, considering the man's charisma, if King had wanted us to become a junior arm of SCLC, it would have happened. I mean, there was nobody there who had the force of oratory that could have overridden King if he had wanted to do it. But I didn't see that happen at all.
I have a very small technical question, a detailed question. I know Marion Barry was the sort of first temporary chair of the temporary committee, but I've seen different things. Some people say that he was elected in April, and some people say he was elected for some documents. I mean, it's a variety of different kinds of evidence. At the first May coordinating committee here in Atlanta, do you have a recollection of that?
Yeah. Marion Barry, okay, that was a battle going on here, okay? My name got put up as the first chairman. The folks from Nashville brought in the guy Marion Barry, that I never heard of before, as their candidate. I thought it would have been Diane Nash, but it was Barry. So you had these this jockeying going along. So finally, a compromise was reached. Let's elect Barry as a temporary chairman, and we'll move the headquarters to Atlanta. And we paid the rent for the first several months, and the records already show that. I mean, I've got the records on that, okay?
That
office paid the rent.
I hadn't seen that, but I have seen some of the financial records that show that the Atlanta group was the only group that, you know, was putting in the donation.
Right, right, but it was for the rent. Mm-hmm. But my position was, we need this organization to coordinate and what have you. There are some people who have the view that if you didn't write it down, then it didn't happen. And that's not really true. But having said that, the move to Atlanta was the best thing that I think SNCC could have done. I don't think they could have done it from Nashville, okay?
It seems like, in retrospect, from an outside perspective, it seems like the logical most.
It was logical because Atlanta historically has been the citadel of intellectual thinking and action in the civil rights movement, beginning really with W.E.B. Du Bois, and when he was at AU for 20-some years, and he had all those wonderful things that he did over there. It's unfortunate that this town, until recently, has never recognized this man's genius. Mm-hmm. I think Clark AU just put up a statue for him. But that's been one of the things. They name all these streets after people who have done nothing in this town or in this country. But because they're part of a certain clique, they can get these things done. How about a guy like Du Bois, who was a giant, not just in these United States of America, but in the world? It's a very interesting town, I'll put it like that.
Can I ask you about Diane Nash? You mentioned Nash, and then you would have thought she would be the person from
Nashville. She should have been.
That?
Not Diane. Diane Nash, in my view, was the Nashville movement. And by that I mean this. Others were there, but they weren't Diane Nash. Diane was articulate. She's a beautiful woman, very photogenic, very committed, and very intelligent, and had a following. I never did understand how, except maybe for sexism, I never understood how Bevel, Marion, and for that matter, John Lewis, kind of leapfrogged over her. I never understood that, because she was, in fact, the leader in Nashville. It was Diane. And the others were followers of hers. Now, Jim Lawson was going, well, he was in the Vanderbilt School of Religion, but he was an adult who was kind of working with the students, but it was Diane. You know, so I never understood that, to be honest with you, but she's an unsung, real unsung hero of the movement in Nashville, in my opinion. Risk her life in order to make this thing happen.
I've seen some accounts, and I don't, you know, again, you know, you get little snippets here and there, and people's memories are different, and some of the, there's some stuff in the papers, and some of it's contradictory. But, you know, one account, and I think Marion Barry says this, is that the expectation it was that Diane Nash would, that the Nashville group wanted to put Nash forward as the chair, and they mentioned this competition with Atlanta, but that at some point or some meeting she wasn't present, and he was, so he became kind of the person.
The consensus? Well, that may have happened because they were having the meetings, you know, because we didn't know anything about that part of it. I was just shocked, though, when they came back, when Barry's name was put forward. I was shocked about that.
And did that
because she was the one who literally put him on the map up there.
Now, was that at Shaw in April, or was that in Atlanta in May?
Diane, well, we actually elected a temporary chairman in at Shaw.
Okay.
Pending going to the next meeting.
Okay.
Yeah. But Barry, by being the temporary chairman, also ended up being the chairman anyway. You know, you know, if you ever get that first leg, yeah. I never understood what the Nashville folks were doing when they overlooked the lady who really mm-hmm. brought them to the table.
So did you had a sense of her reputation?
Oh, yes.
Before you get to
Oh yes. Oh yes. Diane Nash was, in my view, Diane Nash was the most articulate advocate of the movement at that time. Mm-hmm. And I never understood what was happening in Nashville, to be honest with you, except maybe sexism.
Did you have a sense of other student leaders from other communities before that Raleigh meeting?
Yeah, I had read about Franklin Forbes, I guess is his name. I had heard about him. And I had heard about a guy named... Forbes was at Shaw University.
Okay. Was it?
It might have been David Forbes.
David Forbes,
not Franklin. David Forbes.
That's who
David Forbes. Mm-hmm. I'd heard about him, and I heard about Ed King, who came to SNCC, who was put out of Kentucky State. And I heard about a guy named Robinson, who led the movement down at Southern. Mm-hmm. I've forgotten Robinson's, was it Max? It wasn't Max Robinson, Marvin Robinson, yes. I heard about him. I heard about the two sisters down in Tallahassee.
The Stevens sisters?
Is it?
Priscilla and
the
Bishop.
Yeah, the dad is a pastor. Mm-hmm. I'd heard about them. I'd heard about Chuck McDew in Orangeburg, South Carolina. Who else? The movement down in Savannah was being run by the NAACP. I had heard about Mr. Laws, but you're talking about students now. I heard about the students being kicked out of Alabama State, but I didn't know any names until August when Bernard Lee came to join us in Atlanta. Of course, you knew the names of the four kids from Greensboro, but I'd never met them. Mm-hmm. In fact, you know what? I don't recall whether or not those boys were there. Were they there at Raleigh?
Ezell Blair for sure was.
Okay.
He went to a few of the coordinating committee meetings.
Oh, okay, okay.
But they never were really very active in.
Yeah, come to think of it, yeah.
That, yeah. Spark.
Yeah.
In the early days.
Yeah. There. Now, there was another young man, but I learned about him later on after SNCC got started. That was Hank Thomas. Mm-hmm. Hank Thomas and another guy who went around with Hank all the time, Reginald Robinson. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I heard about them later on during the year.
Well, I'll let you get back to the other narrative, but can I ask you about Ed King first?
Because, sure.
Not too many people seem to have known him well or be able to describe him and his role, and I was wondering, I know that you two were, I think, closely together, at least in proximity.
Yeah, I have a picture of Ed King. Ed King.
Is that the one at one of the demonstrations?
Well, he's actually, yeah. Ed King is, the first person to come in here to help us as a secretary and administrative officer was Jane Stembridge. And the second person was Ed King. There are a lot of folks who want to try to pretend like they don't know Ed King, but Ed King was here, and he actually was running this office for Stick. And I don't know why people want to write him out, but by the way, he died in January of last year. I've been trying to find him.
Ago.
No,
really?
No. Ed King died in Montgomery in Prince George's County.
Really?
Yes, I can get you the newspaper stuff. I'll send it to you.
I've heard that.
Ed King, I've been looking for the man, and so finally one day here, I said, let me go find Ed King because he never comes back to these reunions and what have you, and I looked it up, and sure enough, he died in January of 2012, in Prince George's County, and it is the same person. He was born in Virginia, which you probably know. I'm not sure whether it was Roanoke or what have you. And they talked about how he was expelled from Kentucky State. I said, oh, that's him. I felt badly because I had wanted to reach him several years ago, but did not know how to find him. Mm-hmm. Come to find out, the man was less than 30 miles away from me.
Amazing.
But he just kind of dropped out of sight.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Or Wilberforce?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So can you describe him for me or his role?
Yeah, Ed King was very effective in being a coordinator at SNCC. He worked very closely with us in the Atlanta movement, and a person that was especially close to him was Mary Ann Wilson. You know, they were very close. Ed was an articulate speaker. He was courageous, well-organized, and did a job for SNCC at a time when we needed somebody, and he's kind of unheralded, to be honest with you, okay? Now, there's another guy named Ed King who's a white guy from Mississippi, and a lot of folks have confused those two, but there were two Ed Kings.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I know there's
a town. Well, let's go as far as we can.
Yeah, and we'll talk after that.
Yeah.
So, are you ready, John? So,
why don't you get all your questions in, and then I'll do my best to weave other stuff in as you ask questions, because I want to make sure that I answer all your stuff, okay?
Well, you know, some other people might be interested in hearing about some of the big points of the, so why don't you tell me, I know we've talked through some of the boycott activity you were doing in summer of 1960, but then, you know, you resumed the big campaign with the Atlanta student movement in the fall, and I know you had the big arrest with Martin Luther King and some of the strategic decisions and mm-hmm. what happened in the spring. I know that, you know, so if you want to talk about some of those things that you think are particularly significant, then maybe I can fill back in.
Well, we put the plan together. Once we got the inquirer going and we began to get people joining us, we spoke all over town trying to build up a groundswell for the fall campaign. And it was two-pronged. Sit-ins accompanied with boycotts, so forth and so on. And by the way, I just found out here recently, Rich has lost $10 million during that period of time that I just found out.
Somebody told me, it might have been Julian Bond, that you all were looking at the stock exchange.
Yes, we were.
Was that your idea?
Economics major, yes. Dr. Hugo Scholar, yeah, and Dr. E.B. Williams, yeah. We watched them every Sunday. They stopped publishing after a while. But anyway, where was I?
You were talking about the two-pronged approach of the sit-in and the boycott coming in.
Yes, yes. So in September, the students were back. We had the plans. So I presented the summer work as a part of the fall campaign. Here's what we want to do. And I had to battle, believe it or not, with A.D. King, Martin's younger brother, and Bernard Lee to try to get that approved. The issue was, do we wait till October the 19th, or do we go now? And my point was, we want to time this with the presidential election.
So they were eager to get started.
They want to go.
Let's go now.
Now. And so we said, no, let's. And so I prevailed only because the Spelman folks backed me. Okay. You know, they backed me. And we waited until October the 19th. Now, mind you, I had called Martin King in August to tell him about what we were going to do, and he agreed to come at that time. And so Herschel Sullivan, Shalanoa, came back from Paris in September, and she became the co-chairman to take the place of the guy from AU who had graduated, John Mack. So she led the Spelman delegation, and I convinced her to back me on waiting until October the 19th. So on the 18th, I said, Herschel, give Emilye a call. Give Dr. King, I called him Emilye, but give Dr. King a call and tell him to meet me on the bridge at 10 in the morning. So she came back and she said, Lonnie, he said he can't go.
And for our audience, that's the bridge at
Richards. Oh, the Richards, yeah. At Richards Department Store, on the second floor, there was a cafeteria that was over the street between Broad and Forsyth. And it was like you could sit in the cafeteria and you could look at the traffic going up and down those streets. It separated the store from Holmes, which was on the left side, from the regular Richards facility. And so when she called him, he told her that he couldn't go. And I said, well, Herschel, talk to the students here. Let me go talk to him. Because I knew I had a relationship from 1945, you follow me? So I called him up, and of course on the phone was his daddy. Believe it or not, A.D. was on the phone for some reason. Instead of being out there, he was on the phone. Y.T. Walker was in the room. Yeah, they were all there. And so he, in his very slow, deliberate way, he said, I can't go because I was arrested and I'm on probation from an arrest with Lillian Smith out in DeKalb County. And if I get arrested, I've been advised that they'll probably revoke my parole. Not parole, but
probation.
Probation. And his dad, of course, he was bombastic, you know, Daddy King. Anyway, I ignored Daddy King and the other folks on the phone and just talked to him. And I said, Emilye, Atlanta's your hometown. You need to go with us. He had never been to jail voluntarily before then. They would come to get him. I said, but if you get arrested with us, it'll be international news, and I think that's what the movement needs. And I said, Reverend King Sr., do you remember a sermon that you preached a few years ago called You Can't Lead from the Back, You Gotta Lead from the Front? I said, well, Emilye, you can't lead from the back, you gotta lead from the front. That was designed to silence his daddy, who was on my case, by putting it back in his face. And also, Emilye heard that sermon too, because he was there. He said, LC, they call me LC. He said, where should I come tomorrow? I said, 10 o'clock on the bridge. He said, I'll be there. That's how that happened. Well, I believe I talked to Harris Walker, who's still alive, by the way. I was surprised that he was still alive. I called him and left a message for him when I found out he was still alive. And I got a call back on my answer machine where he wanted to know if this is the Lonnie King who got me fired. Oh, God. And so I called him back and I said, yes. Yeah, I said, yes, I did get you fired. And of course, he told me later on about what happened between him and the Kennedys and all that kind of stuff, because they felt he spoke out of school when he did certain things. But anyway, having said that, when King was arrested, it was like a firestorm that went all over the community, all over American and black community. Now, African Americans had been voting, except for Roosevelt, for Republicans since 1867, I guess. And but when Kennedy interceded, or his brother interceded, and Kennedy got the credit for it, after he called Coretta, it switched the votes in a lot of different states, you know, Illinois, Michigan, all over the place. It's made a difference in that election. It was not the dead people in Chicago. It was the live African Americans who voted with their feet for this guy named Kennedy, because they didn't know Kennedy from anybody else. And a lot of them didn't like him because he was Catholic. But King had become by then a symbol of change in the African American community. And that's why they switched over to Kennedy. The historians have tried to minimize the arrest of King by giving it, what's the word I just used earlier, damning with faint praise. But the reality of it is that, but for that arrest, Nixon would have been president, and all of the stuff could have been different, you know, had Nixon become president, okay?
Was your thinking on that influenced by, or I don't know, influenced by part of the same kind of thinking that led SNCC to send delegations to the platform, to speak to the platform committees of the conventions in that summer?
I don't know. I wasn't that involved in that part of it. All I was trying to do was to put the issue of civil rights on the front pages of the people's agenda for this country. Mm-hmm. And I figured that the person that could do it was King. Mm-hmm. And I also felt that the students in Atlanta were organized well enough until we could make it happen. And and of course, that is what happened. Interestingly enough, though, I've learned as I've done more research lately, Richard Nixon did prepare a statement to get involved with the situation to try to neutralize what Kennedy might have done. Because he was going to call Mrs. King, and he was going to, he prepared a statement and gave it to E. Frederick Murrow, the black assistant to the president during that time, to President Eisenhower. He said, let the old man read this statement, because this is what I'm going to say. And when Eisenhower got the statement, he said no. And so Nixon didn't do it because he didn't want to buck the boss. That was a fatal mistake on his part, because what would have happened if Nixon and Kennedy both had spoken out against the injustice that was being perpetrated on King? It might have neutralized the election, and Nixon would probably would have won.
Organizational level of the Atlanta student movement. I don't know. We've been talking now, so I don't know if you've lost it.
I lost it.
How well organized the Atlanta student movement.
Oh yeah. Well, I think that there were two things that were involved here. One is that I went to the military. I learned a lot about how to organize. Plus, I grew up with people who were in the civil rights movement. They were down at the Y all the time, and I listened as a little boy, sucking all this stuff up. Plus, there was a guy who returned here, and we called him El Comandante. He was a retired master sergeant, I guess he was. And he came by and asked me if he could work with us, and I told him yes. He said, I'll work full time, no pay. I think he was retired, you know. And so Comandante came in and got with me, and he was able to pull together a lot of he put some meat on the bones that I had come up with, okay? He was not the one who put the ingredients together. He was the one who put the plan together. You mentioned the two-way radios. Let me tell you how that came about, walkie-talkies. Every time we would, the merchants had a survival strategy. They assumed that if we came in, we probably came in by bus or we came in by car. Once you close the lunch counters, we would go on about our business. And so that was their tactics. When the students show up, don't arrest them, just close. So our response to that was, it was a chess game. So our response was to get us some walkie-talkies, two-way radios, and we have teams of people who were downtown with radios in their car at our communications headquarters on Chestnut Street. We had like a centralized place that was where we could talk to all of them. And so we had spotters. So let's assume, for instance, Richard's department store closed the lunch counter, the Magnolia Room. So our people would go in and leave because they weren't going to arrest them. They didn't want to, because they knew they wanted to be arrested, so they weren't going to do that. And so when we would leave, they'd open right back up. But what they didn't know was that we left sentries around and the walkie-talkies. And so what they would do is that they would call, let's say they've just reopened again, and send the squads in, and we'd send people right back in. They never figured out what we were doing. And so we really harassed them, so finally they just closed them all. But a guy named Ronald Yancey, and another guy whose dad owned the Pilgrim Life Insurance Company, they developed that communication system for us. And they actually ran it from over there. Yeah. Ronald Yancey. He was, by the way, the first black person to finish Georgia Tech.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. He lives up in Columbia, Maryland now. He's retired.
You know, Mary Ann Smith was telling me, and then I saw a little newspaper clip about it, that after the Boynton v. Virginia case, after that decision was handed down, that the Atlanta students had these sort of mini freedom rides.
Well,
number of 60.
Yeah, let me go into that. On about the 4th of December, 1960, the court ruled in Boynton versus Virginia that you shouldn't have discrimination in interstate commerce on these buses and trains. So we had a committee meeting in the next day or two, and we were discussing that issue. And so we decided that we would go and test Boynton versus Virginia. We sent a team to Chattanooga, Columbia, South Carolina, Jacksonville, Florida, Birmingham, Alabama. Yeah. Mary Ann and her sister, I think, went to Birmingham, I believe, and got arrested, I think, when they got back to Atlanta.
That's what she said.
Yeah. Mr. Maurice Pennington, the same artist, and his nephew, and Morris Dillard, went to Chattanooga and got arrested. Norma June Wilson, and I've forgotten who went with her now, went to Jacksonville and they got arrested down in Macon. Charles Black and Otis Moss, whom you might talk to later on, they went to South Carolina. They were hassled up in Athens, but they were not arrested. The idea was to test this decision. Claude Sitton, do you remember him?
I know.
Claude Sitton wrote in the New York Times a few days later about the sit-in.
Do you have that article?
I know it was written. I don't have it. I can probably get it, though, okay?
I tried to find it.
Yeah, but he did write it. And Jim Farmer called me and asked me, tell me more about it. And I told him, he said, well, you know, I tried this earlier, he said, several years ago. I didn't really get too far with it, and we did it kind of up on the other side of the Mason-Dixon line. He said, I think maybe we want to do it. I said, okay. I said, well, when are you going to do it? He said, I'm going to do it in the spring. So he said, we're going to come through Atlanta. I said, when you get to Atlanta, give me a call, and I'll come and talk to you all. And sure enough, when he got here, we went over to Clark College where they were standing. We did talk to him. I was looking at the NAACP files recently in at the Library of Congress, and there's a letter in there from Marvin Rich. Remember him? Marvin Rich to Roy Wilkins, detailing how they were planning the Freedom Rides in the spring. That letter was in February of 1961. But to answer your question, yes, we had the first one, okay? But it was the first one, I guess you'd say, in modern times, because Jim Farmer had done it earlier, back in the 40s. Yeah, that's right, that's right. Yeah, but I think it was outside the South, though, but it was...
Well, it was the Upper South.
Right.
Yeah.
But they have pictures, but we have pictures of all of that.
Those pictures... Are they part of the... Exhibit?
We have pictures, that'll be a part of the exhibit. You had pictures of Norma June Wilson and Mary Ann and... Norma June, Mary Ann, and I believe we may have them at Pennington too. And I think they have a receipt.
All
that's going to be there.
Mary Ann Wilson showed me her.
Yeah, it's going to be there. Yeah, but these are the things that have not been brought out, but we're going to have them over there though.
That's fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Are we okay? I mean, I know one of the things that has been written about a lot with the Atlanta student movement is the sort of relationship between the students and the adults.
I called my 19-year-old grandson who came in.
And he was up. Okay, we're back.
All right. It is what happened in spring of 1961 around the compromise.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's something you want
to
talk about.
Yeah, I'll be happy to talk to you about it.
Yeah.
On the 1st of February, 1960, back during the fall campaign, the Chamber of Commerce types and the mayor, all of them got all involved trying to settle this, but the white merchants would not agree. The powers that be in the white community wanted to try to see if they could find a way to settle the situation on their terms, or terms most favorable to them. And so they had a series of meetings out in the black community with these Negro leaders who were not in charge of the movement now, but they were going to be negotiating for us. Well, once they put all these plans together, where they were going to integrate everything, after the schools desegregated in the fall, after the schools desegregated, not in the fall, but whenever they did it, someone said in that meeting, I wasn't there, but I was told by Senator Leroy Johnson, someone said, we don't control the students. They won't even meet with us when they're going to do strategy. So how are we going to tell Lonnie King? We can't do it unless we get him involved.
Did you know they were having these meetings?
Nope, did not. They were doing it behind my back. So Jesse Hill said, I can get him to come to a meeting. And they said, can you get him to come to a meeting and he not know what's going to be? He said, well, he trusts me. I can get him to come. And sure enough, Jesse Hill called me to ask me to come to this meeting at the Chamber of Commerce. Most important meeting of your life. I said, what is it about, Jesse? Trust me. And so I said, okay. So when I got to the meeting, here were all these powers that be that I've been battling along with the black leaders that were kind of pushed to the side because they didn't have the troops. I had the troops, you follow me? And so they presented to me the proposition. They're going to integrate. By this time now, there's a court decision that the schools have to integrate by the fall. See, they first had those meetings in the late December, January, but then the court ruled And so they were going to do it now after the schools opened, desegregated. And so they wanted a verbal agreement with me to do that. I said, no, I'm not going to do that. So Daddy King jumped up and he said, I'm tired of you, boy. You're going to wreck this town. I baptize you. And so I just ignored it. And the irony of it all, Dr. Crosby, is that the man who came to my defense in that meeting was a man named Frank Neely, who was the chairman of the board of Richard's Department Store, who was sitting directly across from me and had been hitting me on my leg with his cane. He said, Reverend King, he's the only one here who has a constituency. He was elected. We all appointed ourselves. Because what I wanted, I said, let me take this proposition back to the group that I'm representing. And that's what upset King, okay?
So this meeting that you were at,
I was a snookered into a Chamber of Commerce meeting.
Okay, and so it wasn't just, for some reason I was thinking that there was a meeting that it was with the black leaders. But it's this whole
No, the black leaders were meeting with representatives separately. Yeah. But then they pulled this meeting together because they had to get King and they had to get me into it.
And you were the only student.
Hershel Sullivan joined
she
me.
Had that meeting as well?
I asked her to come with me, right.
Okay.
Right. She didn't have anything to say, but she was there. I wanted to witness. Well, when Neely made that comment that I was not wrong, Ivan Allen and A.T. Walden called for a recess. And this time, Dr. Clement came over to me, and he's the president of AU. He came over and said, you were between a rock and a hard place. I said, yeah. He said, you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. And that's all he said. QB Williamson said, I don't know what to tell you. That's the real estate man. And then over comes one of my great he was a great admirer of mine, and I was a great admirer of him, is Mr. John C. Calhoun, who had been the head of the NAACP, who had gone to jail rather than give up the NAACP list to the governor who was going to fire all these teachers. He says, Lonnie, I think you ought to go along with this. I said, why? He said, are you aware that this is the first time that we've ever been able to get white folks in the South to agree to voluntarily do wholesale desegregation without it being mandated by the federal courts? I said, yeah, I'm aware of that. He said, I'm 60 years old. And I have been segregated every day of my life. And if I have to wait from March to September, when I can go downtown and eat anywhere I want to eat and spend my money without being put into the back or being put into the color section, he said, that's a short time. He said, I know you don't like it, but I recommend as one of your advisors that you go along with it. I thought about it, and I said, when we reconvene, I said, I will go along with this on two conditions. One, that it's in writing, and two, that I also be able to go and present it to my students. And that was kind of the way the thing ended. When we left the meeting, and before I could get back to the school, Ivan Allen had held a press conference. I guess he had the press out there in the anteroom somewhere. He announced that the Negro student leaders have agreed to end the boycott, and that the lunch counters will reopen tomorrow, segregated. And that was all he had to say. Man, that was a firestorm in this town. I mean, a literal firestorm. That was when I think the whole town realized that the community had backed us, and they were upset because they knew that we were probably close to victory. So I went back and presented it to the students, and Herschel and I resigned because we've been really just pressured into this mess.
Did you have any thought at that time of going back to the students and saying, okay, we're just going to keep going?
No, I did not. I did not. I just went back and I resigned. Herschel resigned. And the students unanimously refused to accept our resignation. So you've taken us this far, let's call a mass meeting and see what the public thinks. So we call a mass meeting for the 10th of March at Rush Memorial, Dr. Stinson's church, Warren Memorial. And over 2,000 people showed up inside. I don't know how many folks were outside. They had speakers all over the place. It was a wild, wild session. They condemned all of the adult leaders for what they had done. I mean, all of them. And Daddy King got up and said that he'd been fighting for civil rights. He was trying to get order for over 30 years in this town. And before he could make the other sentence, a woman in a white dress, nurse, got up and said aloud, "And that's what's wrong." And when she said that, the place erupted. King had to sit down. Well, I had spoken to Emil earlier. He had just come back to town. He had a little cold. I called him up. I said, "Emil, I need you to come and calm this crowd down." I said, "Because I'm nervous about what's going to happen here." I said, "And they just booed your daddy." He said, "Okay, I'll be there."
So he wasn't there to start with?
He was on Sunset. He was not there. So when he got there, I told Reverend Borders that he was there because Reverend Borders was in charge. I said, "Would you let Emil speak?" And he said, "Yes." So when King got up there, man, he made the greatest speech of his career. The March on Washington speech does not compare to what that man did that night. He took that crowd to the mountaintop, to the valley. He mixed a lot of different speeches into one speech. He had tears in his eyes as he was talking, because they had booed his daddy, okay? But the one thing that he said that I think really carried the crowd was when he said that the agreement may not be all of what it should be, but we cannot afford to have the cancerous disease of disunity in this community. Because if we do, we'll lose. We got to back this. It's not perfect, but it's a start. And the people calmed down. I mean, he literally calmed that whole crowd down. I mean, the guy was a Pied Piper. I mean, now the students and the towns kept the boycott going. I mean, even though the agreement was there, they still wouldn't go back down to the shop. Reverend Wilburn got up. James Wilburn from Union Baptist Church got up, and he said that we're not going back downtown until after September. In other words, if you're going to integrate in September, we'll come back in September. But it was a very, very powerful meeting of conflicting forces. You had the students. You had the young adults, the young Turks. You had the old guard. And you had one or two whites in the audience. Ivan Allen was in the audience. The former mayor, he was in the audience. He's the one who engineered this thing. He was in the audience. He was in the audience. And in one of his things, he wrote that he did not realize how powerful that man was until he went to that meeting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Was he there to... Spy.
He sat in the back, way back in the back, you know.
So it sounds like from what you said, what I've read, that the vast majority of the people in the community, at least who are expressing an opinion, were really against that decision.
Absolutely.
But that it's this small group of traditional leaders that's made this, that's negotiated, and once it was put in that, you know, once you all were in that position, and people went along with it because of that issue of unity?
I think so, yeah. Well, you see, here's the deal. I think that a lot of the people were angry because we had been, well, I had been tricked.
Right.
A lot of them were angry about that. But on the other hand, I think that the more sober people realize that we'd never been to this place before in this town. And I think that they just decided to back down and let's just see, we just aren't gonna go downtown. Mm-hmm. But let me tell you, the one thing that has not come out that often, you know, I ask at the height of the boycott, I ask people to send me their credit card, their richest credit card. I ask you a rhetorical question. If a college student asks you to send him or her your credit card today, would you send it? (laughs) 353 people sent me their credit card. And we put it in a safe deposit box at Citizens Trust Bank and sent it back to them when the boycott was over. I'm telling you that because that tells you, even though that's a small number, that's telling you the breadth and the length and the depth to which this movement had reached the masses, not the classes, but the masses. You know, when people believe enough in what you're doing to say, I trust my credit in your hands. How many of those folks knew Lonnie King, a college student? Who's he? You know, I'm not some prominent preacher, but we had been, but people I think saw that I was honest. I wasn't trying to steal anything. I wasn't trying to get anywhere. We're just trying to end the system of segregation. That's all. And people backed it. Again, it's that fast dime versus the slow dollar.
Mm-hmm. So if we're going to wrap up the videotape portion of this soon.
I'm going to let you carry and I'm going to respond.
So, I was actually wondering if you'd like to, if we need to end at 4, you had said you needed to go at 4.
Yeah.
So, would you like to say a few words about how this has impacted your life and influenced you, what you think is significant to sort of use for your last 10 minutes on this form, and perhaps we can follow up either in another format or another day?
Dr. Crosby, I see this as a continuation of a journey that began in my life with my granddaddy. When you think about him recruiting those 50-cent memberships, even I mean, he had his collar turned on backwards as a preacher. And I'm sure he was alive because he was a preacher. Because to be a member of the NAACP, even in some of these towns today, is dangerous. And so I think in a way I was in the right place at the right time with the right whatever to be able to bring all of this stuff to bear at, in one place at one time in 1960. But I was just one of a lot of people, at least 100 of us, I think, in different places had a similar kind of a role, some much larger, some a lot smaller. The thing that I see in retrospect is that the civil rights movement of the 1960s was the greatest movement in this country since the ending of slavery. Because what it did was the movement acted like a volcano erupting that became something akin to a giant firecracker, that when it got to a certain apogee, you know, those firecrackers that explode and things just kind of simmer down. When African Americans, Negroes, challenged the system and won and got in Title VII, where it had in it the section dealing with discrimination based on race, color, creed, national origin, sex. That opened up the floodgates, or that created the umbrella, that created the groundswell for the women's movement, the Latinos, the gays. When these things, these embers began to flow back down, it reached all kinds of people. The irony of it all, though, is that the masses of blacks who many of whom lost their lives and whatever, they're still at the back of the bus in terms of economics. And women have taken over, they have become the conductor almost of the bus. When you look at the Fortune 500 companies, they're proliferated all over the place. Hispanics are doing a great job, even though they're trying to hold them down, they're doing a great job of beginning to inculcate themselves into the mainstream. Asians have done the same thing. But I cannot just blame the system entirely on the plight of African Americans. I think it also has to do with a lot of African Americans not preparing themselves as they should for opportunities as they open, and for also not being long distance runners too. You have to accept, in my opinion, that there are gonna be people around who aren't gonna like you. They don't like how you look, what you wear, or what your color is. That's always the case. I mean, people don't go out and marry folks that don't appeal to them. So you got this prejudice going on that's almost innate. But how do you overcome it? You overcome it by changing the laws, and hopefully you can change the customs, and in the long run, change people's attitude. But not enough of the African-American community, in my view, is willing to realize that many of us were born looking up at the bottom. And in order to get out from under the bottom, you got to work, you got to hustle, you got to work. A classic example is one that you may have seen in the newspaper on MSNBC the other day. There's a young woman in town who finished high school as valedictorian of her class a few days ago, a young black woman. She and her sister finished high school. The sister as a salutatorian at another high school. The two of them plus two other siblings and their mother have lived in a homeless shelter for the last several years. You have to turn out the lights in these homeless shelters at a certain time. So what did this young woman do? She put a blanket over her head, and she used the light from her cell phone to study. So now she's coming to Spelman College on a full scholarship, getting her first bed that she can now sleep in years. She's not coming as a freshman, she's coming as a junior, because she took these advanced courses when she was going to high school, and she wants to become an oncologist. I don't know what her sister wants to become. But apparently, she didn't say, oh, I'm black, or I'm female, oh, I'm in these bad circumstances. The question is, how do you get yourself together to get out of that circumstance? And I don't think we have enough people in my community who are trying to encourage, who are trying to write the right kind of thing on these young people's slate. That's a part of my problem as I see it. So I'm going to go to my grave maybe later rather than sooner. But before I go, I'm certainly hoping that I can convince some more people to take a second look at what's happening. We cannot afford to blame the system for everything, because we are part of the system, and we need to do our job to try to get these young people, that's the hope of this whole world, attuned to looking for the top.
Okay.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress and the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture.